Good evening.
Good evening, Father.
If you don't mind, I am going to video this discussion for two reasons. One, because some of our brothers and sisters aren't able to attend, so that they can also take part in it. And number two, because it'll give me an opportunity to go back and watch it again and reflect about what you said. For this is a very serious topic that we're going to approach. The name of the book is An Autopsy of a Deceased Church by Thomas Rainier. And how we will approach it is to look at our two parishes, St. Thomas and St. Bridget, and see, or hopefully see, what is our strengths, what is our weaknesses. For as he said in the introduction, when he described the patient, a patient who was dying, it was inevitable. But the patient did not want to be honest and look at the illness, fought tremendously, but eventually died. And the patient was a church. So I wanted to look at it and really see if we can be proactive rather than reactive. There's two types of, I think, maintenance that people do. You do proactive maintenance and reactive maintenance. Proactive maintenance, we change our air conditioning filter first of the month. Reactive, we didn't do it, messed up the air conditioning, now we've got a bigger bill on our hands. So what we'll do is we'll approach it through his series of discussion questions. Is everybody okay so far? Okay. I just ask, please, if you have a question, just remember to speak loudly and clearly. Okay? He asked a question. And again, there is no right or wrong answer. This is your honest, reflective opinion. If our church, St. Thomas or St. Bridget, was given a physical examination, how would our diagnosis, how would it be? What would it look like? Would or could we say our church is healthy? Our church is slightly sick, very sick, or dying? What do you think, looking at St. Thomas the way you see it as her parishioners, looking at St. Bridget the way you see it as her parishioners, how would you honestly answer that question? St. Bridget's is dying. That's your opinion.
St. Thomas would be very sick.
You believe St. Thomas is very sick.
Are you evaluating St. Thomas since the point at which you closed the school, or going back to and having the school closed be part of?
We're talking about it today.
This point on.
Yes, from this point on.
I don't say sick. I don't know if I'd go very sick, but I believe sick. We don't have enough young people in the church, especially children.
Sick, no young people, no children.
But it's going back up. There was a point where we had almost none. But you're beginning to see a little bit of growth.
You believe we're beginning to see a little bit of growth in younger families? Occasionally, babies are crying. So, Bridget's, you would think, might be in worse condition?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Okay. Now, you mentioned younger families, young people, babies. Do you believe, honestly, the amount of young people and young families we have, is that anywhere near the amount of older families that we have?
No.
No. So it's not a good ratio?
No.
How many would you guess? I don't know an answer. Would you guess we're over 50, 60, or 70% right now of older parishioners? An older, I would say, let's say 65 and above.
Seventy-five.
Bridget, you believe 70?
We're about 60-40 here, I think.
You believe about 60-40 to 65 years to know? Interesting. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I think it's worse.
You think it's worse?
I think there's like 70% older people and
when we did the just the yes sir.
Will you ask maybe what a healthy church is? Maybe like set the stage for what a healthy church would be?
Okay, what do you feel is a healthy church?
A 50-50 ratio.
60-40 young over the older. But in your mind, let's go deeper. What would be your image of a healthy church?
A more active, people are more active in the church, more parishioners.
A school.
More youth.
You know, younger people.
A lot of younger people.
And not seeing the same people playing roles all the time.
I can't hear you.
And seeing different people playing the roles because you're seeing the same people because they're the only ones willing, more than likely.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
You're
right.
So you would say a healthy church would have much more young people than what we would have. It would be more active.
Yeah.
Active how?
Participation in services, participation in CCD, because we have more families with younger kids that aren't participating in CCD. We need a school again. We need to move.
We need a Catholic school.
Uh-huh.
Catholics need to raise their children in Catholic schools.
Well, we're not there as far as a Catholic school yet. No, we're away from that. We're just trying to stop with a basic foundation. What is our view of a healthy parish? And then, as you have just said, activity, participation, more young. Then I ask you to revisit your question. Are we a healthy parish?
No, Father, just think about this. I mean, I think that the last two christenings, possibly, for my grandchildren, and they don't even live in this town, they live in Texas. We do a lot of funerals. We rarely do a wedding or a christening here. And that's the cycle of life, you know, the christening and then the marriage and then the funeral. But we do lots and lots of funerals. Rarely do we do a wedding here, and rarely do we do a christening. Probably more christening than weddings.
Weddings we've done probably maybe 5 or 6 in my 12 years here.
See, I think we're dying. I'm sorry, I think we are.
I would think that both parishes.
Both parishes are.
You have so many different ministries that are available that nothing is being done. This one is there. Bringing communion to the shut-in, teaching catechism, altar servers. There's all kinds of ministries available. Nobody's doing.
If I could.
It doesn't have to be the interest thing. There's no interest, apparently.
Well, I would like that. We do have someone visiting the St. Thomas.
Yeah, St. Thomas. Well, Bridget, we have one or two that goes occasionally.
If I could echo.
But on a regular basis.
We do have people who go on Bridget's regular basis.
Okay.
Yes.
But just to echo on what George was saying, as a, I would say relatively newer parishioner who's St. Bridget's, I've been there a little over 4 years. When I first came to the church, I don't know, I didn't know what was available. I still don't know what kind of activities are available to me. I did not know about a women's group until maybe a year and a half ago. Now I am involved in CCD only because someone approached me and said, hey, I need help.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know about a women's group. I don't know what kind of activities are available.
Okay, that's...
As a young person.
That's a very good point. So we need to get our message out more as to the availability, what we have. Okay, thank you. That's a good point. Yes, ma'am.
We need more community involvement. More community involvement?
More community involvement.
We live in an area of so many Baptist churches. I dropped my child off at school this morning and they're doing prayer at the flagpole, and which is awesome, but we're not represented. They're having some thing after school this evening from different churches that are bringing the youth there in celebration, but we're not involved. I mean, we need to be involved in our community just like the Baptist churches.
Sadly, a lot of that is by invitation.
We can just get on up in there. I mean, if you wait to be invited, we'll never be asked. We can approach them.
Would you?
Sorry?
Would you?
Yeah. I would.
But I think a lot of people in this community have a strange understanding with Catholicism. I can remember, it hadn't been that many years ago, when my husband and I were at Waterburger, and he ran into a man that he went to high school with at Beiger in the 60s. And he was a very nice man, and he was inviting us to come to his church. And I said, well, I appreciate that. I said, but I pointed the window and said, this is our church, and we'd love to have you come there. He goes, well, that's a Catholic church, like we were devil worshiping. I said, sir, you realize that Catholicism was the first Christian religion? And he looked at me like I'd lost my mind, and he smiled and walked off.
I'm living with people with those kind of thoughts.
Well, let me ask you. If you believe this church is, or St. Bridget's, both churches are sick, very sick, or dying, then why are people not acknowledging that?
Because, you know, I grew up in a Protestant church. I went to Baptist churches, mostly in Presbyterian churches growing up. I became a Catholic a week before my wedding, and I was almost 19 years old. And I just noticed that people, when they came to the Catholic church, pretty much they were, it's a little bit different now. People were very quiet. When I first started coming to Catholic church, which I really liked, when you first came in, people were very quiet and you know, kneel and pray and that sort of thing. But I noticed that, like in the Baptist churches, they were a lot more, like if you didn't come to church, they'd be calling you, coming to your house, and if you weren't here last Sunday, we were just checking to make sure you're okay. And sometimes that's okay, and sometimes it kind of got on my nerves, you know, like you know, leave me alone, I'll come to church when I want to. But, you know, it's a different type of a culture. It is a completely different culture. And one thing I noticed, like, when I came to the Catholic churches, as far as singing, people don't do a lot of singing. And we have beautiful songs and stuff, but if you go like this in Baptist churches, I mean, people are almost yelling the singing. It's just a completely different culture. It is. It's just very, very different.
But again,
but I prefer this myself. I mean, other
but,
people
but
don't
my
like
question,
this.
I guess my question is, if you believe we're dying, then why are we not addressing it? Why are we just sitting there? Yes, ma'am.
If you admit there's a problem, then you have to make a decision. Are you gonna change and do something different? Or are you just gonna let that problem continue to escalate?
Which one's the easiest?
And most people don't like change. Most people don't. And, but you have to make a decision. As long as you ignore it, you don't have to make a decision and you don't have to do anything different. And that's just kind of a fundamental principle about.
Okay, so do you believe we are ignoring the issue of our parishes?
I believe most of them are in denial.
Most people are in denial.
I mean, think about what happened when you changed the masses.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said, you know what I'm saying, that's the way we've always done it.
That's the way we've always done it, yeah, okay.
When we changed that mass, it was.
It changed quite a bit, I'm sorry. The Catholic Church did change quite a bit after Vatican II.
Okay.
When we changed the mass to 4:30 Sunday afternoon, I mean, it was like we had committed the ultimate sin.
When we switched the mass, when the people voted for the mass to change from Saturday night to Sunday, how they got mad because they did not win.
Yeah, they wanted their mass at their time.
One mass, so they left the parish.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I had one tell me, he didn't leave the church left him when they changed the mass.
He left the church, and he said that the church left him because he voted for Saturday night,
right,
and a majority of the people in a fair election with no tampering voted for Sunday night.
Well, again, a lot of that problems because we have a lot of older people. You know, you get set in your ways and you don't want to change.
Well, again.
We did real good about that.
Yes, sir.
My thinking would be that I wouldn't expect to have a lot of impact in what we're trying to do. So, like, if a church has for a long time been a certain way, I would think I'm not going to be able to change it. I don't have the power to do it. It's like when you have a brand new car. If you just wax it every day, it looks great. It's pretty easy to get it to mint, right? But if it's an old beater, you think, well, I'm never going to be able to get it back the way it looks. So, so I think impact has to be a big part of why people don't change things.
Impact.
Why?
I don't have a sense of powerlessness.
Sense of powerlessness? Do you? So, have we reached a stage where we are kind of accepting of the fact that this is just the way it is at Thomas and Bridget's and we're going about it because that's just the way it is.
But
is that what you think we as a parishes, as a whole, is that what we're doing? God bless you.
I think again that the majority of people at both parishes are older and they're just comfortable, you know?
That we have become comfortable.
Right. I think they're comfortable. This is the way it is, and this is fine. Yeah.
Well, and to some extent, tired. So people eventually reach a point where they are too elderly to be the folks that are in there, you know,
absolutely,
doing the, you know, washing the dishes and making the repairs and doing this and that.
So that brings up a good point that we addressed earlier. If our older people are getting tired and we don't have the younger people to replace them, then what happens then? So, as you can see, it looks like a majority of you, when you compared what you thought was a healthy church to what you think we are today at Thomas and Bridges, it would seem that we're not healthy. There's no way to sugarcoat that. We've reached a stage of complacency to a certain degree. We're comfortable. Would I be correct in some of y'all's beliefs of like that?
We talk about, it almost sounds like we're sort of internalizing this sense of blame without talking about the external factors. You know, 25% of the population in the United States now says I'm atheist or at best agnostic. The immediate vicinity, like somebody mentioned, you know, Sierra Leone has almost 40 churches, most of them Baptist. I'm not really sure about Chickasaw, but it's a different, people are looking at a different worship style and belief system, people who are people of faith. So, I mean, there are external factors, too, that I'm not really sure how, I don't personally know how you approach the unchurched and so forth, but, I mean, there are external factors, too.
I don't know about, I mean, I haven't been to the Baptist Church Ranger, but if you go to some, I've been to, like, some different funerals to Baptist churches in Mobile, and some of it's almost like a big production. I mean, they have, like, electric guitars up there, and just, you know, it's just like a big, and big screen TVs everywhere, and it's just...
Yes, but let us stay focused on us.
Yeah.
Because this is what we have to always focus. This is about us. This is about St. Thomas and St. Bridget.
Them to us.
We got to fix us before we can get them to us.
Okay. We have to be willing to accept change.
Okay, you're saying that we have to fix, we have to be willing to accept change.
Yeah.
Good music, different music. Drawing more of the young people.
What we're saying is the issue is bigger than just if we brought in a rock music. There is something, y'all are saying, there is something definitely wrong, and it's more than just the music. Okay.
You mentioned several weeks ago about, you know, us going out and presenting, you know, ourselves as good Christians and letting people see that. But when you talk about changing things, look, it seems to me that the liturgical churches have a lot less flexibility in how they can do that. You know, the Catholic, the Orthodox, the Lutheran, the Episcopalian, you know, they have more of a set liturgy. They can't just willy-nilly kind of do things the way some of the others.
But I think what we're saying is the issue here and at Bridget's is greater than music. It's greater than the way we worship. There is something fundamentally missing here that we have become comfortable with, and we may be not knowing what that is that we're missing yet.
I keep hearing on Catholic radio and television talking about, as Catholics in general, we're not inviting people, and that's a lot of the converts' reason is, why didn't you become Catholic before? And they would say, nobody invited me. So that might be part of the problem. We've never invited those people that we think who are already Catholic. And
okay,
we should be in our parish.
That we haven't invited.
It's a very different culture. But we went to a Baptist church one night for some sort of baseball thing. Our son was on a baseball team many years ago. We went to that church one night, I think it was on a Wednesday night. That Saturday, a whole congregation of people came to our house and wanted us to come to their Baptist church. You know, I invited them in. I said, well, thank you for the invitation, but we're Catholic. I'm very, you know, happy at my church. I said, I actually converted. Catholicism. And Catholics don't normally do that kind of stuff. But that's, you see that in Baptist churches a lot.
Yes, ma'am.
I think that a lot of the people just have no interest in wanting to change anything. That's just like tonight. Last weekend, you invited them, and you told them what we were going to be discussing and try to help our churches to grow and see what we can do to fix the problem.
Yes, ma'am, we did invite.
Look how many people are here tonight.
Pretty much the same crowd.
Yes. So that shows a lot.
No, there's a few more.
So it's pretty much the same crowd. Does it mean exactly the same crowd? Pretty much means pretty much.
But again, a lot of it's because people are older. A lot of people when they're older don't want to drive when it gets dark. you know, those sorts of things.
But the young, but the young people should show up. I mean, we invite them, they should be here to see what's going on. Hopefully they will listen to this on the video, and maybe next week, maybe more, they will show up.
How many of the Catholic families out here have little kids, and they go to the churches in town, the Catholic churches, because they have the schools? So they keep going in there to be with the kids.
Again, I think we're way too far advanced in that. If we bring it back, and that's what we have to do, we have to approach this very methodically, as you would with an examination of a patient. First off, we have to diagnose a problem. Are we sick? Yes, everybody seems to be in agreement. Am I correct? Everybody's in agreement, we're sick. Okay. Now, what we will do in the course of this book is take our time, read a chapter, and we're going to approach this as a doctor. Dr. Lopez would be my great example here. Thank you, doctor. Would approach an illness. They'll have to, we'll run some tests and see, vis-a-vis the chapters, if this applies to us. And we're looking at this, and that's why I want y'all to keep coming back to Thomas. I'm not interested in the Baptist churches. God bless them. They're the Baptists. You know, they're doing their own thing, and they're doing it well. Focus on us. Look at us. Stay with us. Examine St. Thomas and St. Bridget. Make it the focus.
Can I say something?
Yes, ma'am.
One thing that I noticed that is missing in our church,
yes, ma'am,
is fellowship and
social help.
When someone's sick, we're not taking care of those people like we should. We should be checking on our people and letting them know that we love on them. And
okay, you said we should be checking on our people and letting them know.
Yeah, and let them know that we love them and, you know, that we're praying for them. And
we do that through individual members who bring them communion once a week. Okay. Charlie Gross, Deacon Bullock, Joan Squires.
Okay, I didn't know that.
George
at St. Bridget, Bob Bachman at St. Bridget's. We do that.
But I mean as a whole.
Now,
as a congregation.
Mm-hmm.
Right. We should love on our neighbors, our community. And
okay, then that begs a very good question to examine. Are we as individuals noticing who's coming to the Mass that we attend, and when they're not there, are we reaching a hand out to them?
Some of them.
Well, that's a question you have to ask yourself.
Yeah, if you miss somebody's Mass for 2 or 3 weeks, then you know you need to contact them.
But I would agree. We would know these things. But in my heart, looking at me, am I doing it? And I can only come up with one word. It's either yes or no. And we have to honestly ask each ourselves that.
That's also something you see in certain churches. They have certain people who head up those committees. Like I know in some churches, if a woman has a baby, then they have a group of women that make supper, and they take supper to her house like for 10 days after the baby's born, surgery and that sort of thing. And I've seen that more in Protestant churches. I mean, like I said, I've only been involved.
But are we seeing it here?
No, we're not. And again, a lot of times it's not an older person doing it, it's someone who's a little bit younger. And I think, this is just my opinion, I think our biggest problem, we don't have enough young people in this church. We don't. Because I notice myself, I'm tired. I'm almost 62 years old. I work full time. I take care of mom. I don't have a lot of energy and don't want to do a whole lot of extra stuff. I just don't.
Okay.
But, you know, when I was was younger, I did a whole lot of extra stuff.
Okay, so why don't we do this? Let us read chapter 2 next week. That's going to start the process of looking at various symptoms and seeing if these symptoms are things that we are ailing with. And if so, how can we, as a community of Thomas and Bridget's, come together and remedy these illnesses? Because you have all acknowledged we're sick. There's a problem. Let us now diagnose it. Okay? All right. Y'all have a good night. Almighty God bless you, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.